Good afternoon and welcome to About Health. I'm Rona Renner, here twice a month with you to explore different concepts of health and well-being. I'm a nurse, parenting coach, author, and grandma of five. You know, I've recently had conversations with different people about death and dying and the choices people make regarding things like advance directives and how to make their death easier on the people they leave behind. I did a show about dying kindness in December of 2021, and I highly recommend people check out dyingkindness.com for resources and the podcast that Sienna Stewart does. But one of the topics we didn't cover when I spoke with her on About Health is the concept of medical aid in dying. It's a practice that allows a terminally ill person who has a prognosis of 6 months or less to live to ask their doctor for a prescription for medication that they can take if they decide they want to. I realized that I wasn't up to date on the laws and also the process that someone can undertake if they have a terminal illness. And I wanted to know more about how people can die without needless suffering in this way. I reached out to the folks at Compassion and Choices to learn more and to help others understand this option that may be right for you or a loved one at the end of their life. This option is available in California as well as other places across the country. I'll open the phone lines in a bit, and I welcome your concerns, your questions, your experiences. The phone number is 800-958-9008. You can also email me anytime during the show at nurserona@kpfa.org. So is this something you've thought about? Have you talked with your doctor about this option? I look forward to taking your calls a little bit later in the show. But joining me now is Samantha Trad. She is the National Director of Care Advocacy for Compassion and Choices. In this role, she works to expand patient-centered and directed end-of-life care across the country. She's also an expert on implementing medical aid in dying laws and leads education and outreach efforts to eliminate barriers for eligible patients who want the option of medical aid in dying. Before working at Compassion and Choices, she taught American politics at the University of Redlands, and she was the executive director of the Arizona Advocacy Network. Samantha Trad, welcome to About Health.
Thank you so much for having me, Rona, and for talking about this important topic.
It's a pleasure. And I think I really want to thank you for making time. And I want to start off asking you, you know, you were a political science person. So I'm really curious as to know how you got interested in end-of-life work. So tell us a little bit.
Absolutely. When I was growing up, my mother actually had a terminal illness. And so in my family, we talked about death and dying a lot. And it was a really important idea for my mom to be able to be in control of her end of life. She didn't want to suffer at the end of her life. And I grew up in the 80s and 90s, right around when Oregon, which was the very first state to authorize medical aid in dying, they authorized in the 90s. And I remember talking to my parents, and, you know, my mom even considered whether or not she should move to Oregon because California didn't have this option at the time. And she was really afraid of the course her terminal illness was going to take her down. And I remember just being shocked that we didn't have this option, you know, that my mom would maybe have to move. We would all have to maybe move to another state just so she could peacefully end her suffering. And so it's always been an issue I've been very passionate about because I think everyone should have full autonomy at the end of life to have the end of life experience that they want. And so thankfully, California now has this option. And So my mom didn't have to move. Actually, my mom was able to get a liver transplant and was put on some experimental medication that turned out to work. So she's actually, you know, 20 plus years later, she's still alive.
Wow.
And
that's great.
Very supportive of my work. Yeah. Yeah.
Oh, that's a really good story. Thanks for telling it. And yeah, so you were drawn to this, it seems, in a very, very personal way. Maybe you can tell people about the criteria. Let's get right into it. The criteria for medical aid in dying, and what are some of the key things people need to know?
Absolutely. And the most important thing I want everyone to remember from this conversation is, have the conversation as soon as possible with your healthcare provider. Talk to your doctor. Ask them if they would write you a prescription if you became eligible. Because one of the hardest things is finding a doctor who can support you in the option. And part of this, a large part of it actually, is because Catholic health systems don't let doctors practice. Any doctor can opt out if they don't want to do it, which is fine. But there are a lot of healthcare facilities and hospices that don't let their doctors practice if they want to practice. This is true especially for Dignity Health. They're a Catholic healthcare system, so if you're at Dignity Health, you cannot access this option there. So the sooner you have these conversations, the better. So in order to qualify for medical aid in dying, there's actually a 13-step process a patient has to go through. We have the information on our website, but I'll give you just the cliff notes so you don't feel too overwhelmed. In order to qualify, first of all, you need to be an adult. You must have a terminal illness with a prognosis of 6 months or less to live. This is an option for people who are imminently dying. You also have to be mentally capable of making medical decisions. This means this is not an option for someone who has advanced Alzheimer's, for example. It's really not even necessary to put it in your advanced healthcare directive because you have to ask for this option on your own. You have to advocate for it on your own multiple times in order to qualify. So those are the eligibility requirements. You also have to be able to self-ingest the medication, which means that a lot of patients drink the medication, or if you have a feeding tube or an anal catheter, you have to be able to push the plunger so that it is self-administering the medication into yourself. This is not euthanasia. There is no physician assistance. That's why we use the term medical aid in dying. So that's right. The eligibility requirement.
Yeah, and yeah. I'm looking at your website. There was a form that I downloaded, attending physician checklist and compliance form, mm-hmm. and it really spells a lot out there. There are a lot of good resources on your website, and it says that the number three was the determination that the patient has the capacity to make medical decisions. And I think that's a really important and interesting eligibility criteria. How do they determine if the patient has the capacity to make this decision?
That's a great question. So in California, a patient has to be evaluated by two different doctors, and at least one of the doctors, the main doctor who ends up writing the prescription, has to evaluate the patient two different times. So the patient goes through three different consultations, and each of the physicians is trained. They can tell if the patient has this mental capability. It's one of the things they're looking for. And if the physician wants, they can always have an optional mental health specialists determine whether or not the person is mentally capable of making these medical decisions. So, for example, the main doctor can refer the patient to a psychologist, psychiatrist, social worker, someone else, if they're not certain that they meet that mental capability requirement. And they also check to make sure the patient isn't undertreated for depression. It's really important that the patient understands that, you know, they're choosing this option to peacefully end their suffering. And again, these are people who are imminently dying. This is not an option for someone who is suffering from depression, who is not terminally ill. But I do also want to make sure listeners understand, you know, if a person does have depression, and, you know, a lot of people who are terminally ill have some sort of depression, if it's being treated, then they're absolutely still eligible and can qualify for medical aid in dying.
Wow, there's a lot to unpack there. We'll definitely get back to dementia at some point. I want to talk more about that, because you still talk about that on your website and you help people with that. But first, I want to ask you just to clarify the relationship between medical aid in dying and a healthcare directive. Because, you know, we've talked about healthcare directives on this show, and it's so important. I'm still working on finishing mine. I am admitting here that I'm not done yet. I promised myself I would do it if many months ago. I'm getting close. But it's really important that people have an advanced directive, and it's on their, you know, medical records, or some family member has it, but it's nice that the doctor has it. And what's the relationship with medical aid in dying and that advanced care directive?
Yeah, that's a great question, and I'm glad you're honest, and I'm glad you're filling it out. It's so important to have it. And, you know, just a side note, having an advanced health care directive is so important, but if nobody sees it, nobody can find it, then it doesn't matter. So just a reminder that once you fill out your advanced health care directive, make sure your medical providers have a copy of it. Make sure you have a health care proxy, someone who can advocate for you, who knows what you want, depending on the circumstance, when you're unable to advocate for yourself. And especially if, you know, you're reaching the end of your life, you maybe don't want to be resuscitated. You know, when somebody goes through resuscitation, it's not like in the movies. I wish it was like in the movies, but your ribs are broken. It can be really a traumatic experience. And so there are some people who actually, depending on the circumstance, you know, they don't want to be resuscitated. And so it's really important to make sure that everyone knows what your end of life wishes are. You can even make a video and send it to your family on your phone if you have a smartphone, so that it helps everyone know what you want. And we've heard so many stories from family members where, you know, their loved one was in a situation where they didn't know what their loved one wanted. And, you know, one brother thought one thing, a sister thought another, you know, the dad thought something else, and it just adds to the confusion, the grieving. So that's why it's so important to make sure you have your people know what you want. Now, how does this relate to medical aid in dying? Well, as I mentioned before, you know, a person has to advocate orally themselves to their physicians. This is not something you can ask for if you're in a coma, for example, or like I said, if you have some form of advanced dementia and you're confused and you don't understand what you're asking for. So that's why it's, you know, you can put it in your advanced health care directive. Some people do it just to help start the conversation with their physician. But you cannot access the option through your advanced health care directive. Now, let's talk a little bit about dementia, because a lot of people are rightfully very interested in the stages of dementia and the end of life options that are available for people with dementia, because there are some people who live for a very long time with dementia in a state that maybe they wouldn't have wanted if they had understood mm-hmm. what their end of life options were. So, as I mentioned, medical aid in dying is not an option for dementia, but there are other options. So, for example, if you make it clear in your advanced healthcare directive that, let's say, you want to refuse treatment. So, for example, let's say a person with dementia has pneumonia. Well, normally we treat it with our amazing advanced medical sciences, you know, antibiotics, whatnot, to help the person heal, because that feels like the compassionate thing. Well, actually, maybe you don't want to have that pneumonia treated. Maybe you just want to have your pain treated so that the patient is comfortable. And then if you make it clear, you can let the pneumonia take its natural course to peacefully end that person's life if that's what you want. So refusing treatment is actually a compassionate end-of-life option that we don't always think about. that we sometimes are afraid to talk about.
That's right. It's,
yeah,
that's really important. Yeah, no, it's so important that you mentioned that. You know, my mom was 96, and she had full dementia. By the time she was 96, she was having trouble knowing who we were, and COVID hit the facility that she was at, and I think within 5 days she died. And, you know, they were asking if we wanted her to go to the hospital. And, you know, we all said, no, of course, we want her to be with the people she knew at the facility she was at. They even let me be on the phone with her, you know, while she was dying. And we were brokenhearted that we couldn't be in person because of COVID. But I think what you're bringing up is really important, that there are ways to have the conversation again before the person has full dementia, you know, to for the family to really know that the person that you love, you know, is really interested in having some kind of compassionate death rather than living on in a place that they never wanted to be. And they really deeply didn't want to stay. And so those are the conversations we're encouraging people to have. And the idea also is that you can talk with your doctor now to find out, is this someone who would be comfortable, you know, giving you a prescription when the time comes? And again, we can answer your questions about that, because certainly if you're if you fit the criteria for medical aid in dying, you don't have to take the medication. But so many patients say they feel so much comfort just knowing they have it. And I think like 30-something percent of people don't take it. Is that right, Samantha?
Yes. Yeah, it's really, it's an interesting statistic, because we see it in all the authorized states. So now there are 10 states in Washington, D.C. have all copied Oregon, basically, and authorized medical aid in dying. And from all the data, it's about 30% of people who go through this whole long process to get the medication never actually take it. But just having it on hand gives them such a huge sense of relief. I think about Barry Stroud. He was a professor at Berkeley who wanted the option of medical aid in dying. He got his medication, and every day he would ask his daughters to show him the medication. And he was a professor of philosophy at Berkeley. And so every day he would say, okay, is today the day? And he'd think about it and he'd talk about it. And he never ultimately took the medication. He surprised himself. He thought he would have wanted to take it, but actually the quality of life was okay for him, and his daughters are so grateful, and he was so grateful he had that medication on hand, because if he didn't, he would have felt like he had no control over his terminal illness. It would have been a much more anxious, you know, just terrible experience for his end of life. So just having it, just in case he wanted it. And that's why I tell people, talk to your doctor today. I'm a healthy 40-year-old woman. I've never had any major illnesses in my adult life. And I've had the conversation with my doctor, because you never know what could happen. And I want to make sure that if there's, you know, 1% chance that I end up getting some horrible disease where I might need medical aid and dying, I might want it. I want to make sure that my doctor will support me in it. And when I had the conversation with my doctor, he'd never thought about it before. You know, a lot of doctors are trained to extend life at all costs. You know, they're not trained on end of life. And by the way, we do have doctors who do clinical education for physicians on end of life. But, you know, when you have that conversation with your doctor, you could actually be helping another patient you don't even know, because it's going to start the wheels rolling in your physician's head thinking, okay, is this something I'm comfortable doing? Is this, you know, what does it mean to support my patient the way they want to be supported? It can have tremendous ripple effects.
That's a really good point. I encourage patients to educate their doctors all the time, because there are a lot of things that doctors don't have a chance to learn about. You're listening to About Health. I'm Nurse Rona, and I'm pleased to be joined in studio by Samantha Trad. She's the National Director of Care Advocacy for Compassion and Choices. The phone lines are open now, and you can join this conversation. Call us at 1-800-958-9008. That's 800-958-9008. 9008 with your questions about this choice in end-of-life care. Or you can also email me at nurserona@kpfa.org. Is this something you've thought about? Do you know someone who has chosen this path to compassionate death? And I believe very deeply that it's important to talk about death and dying. It's so important not to be afraid to have conversations with our families and with other people. And I notice that the more I'm able to think about and talk about this, the more I am able to live really a beautiful life, in the sense that it's not depressing to talk about the fact that we're all going to die someday. And it's really interesting to have that conversation with the people you love. I also want to thank all of you, by the way, who donated to this last fund drive. Your support is phenomenal. Your gifts are really well needed and used here at KPFA. Your support means that KPFA can continue to bring you vital information about our world, our country, and local news, and about your community. And the staff here work really hard to do the work to stay up to date on the things that are really vital to our well-being. So thank you very much. You can go to the website at kpfa.org and still donate. There are still gifts there if you want them. Okay, Samantha, so let's keep diving into this. Why is it important to have these conversations? And you've already said that you never know when this is going to happen to you, and you can educate doctors. What else do you think is important in terms of why we have these conversations? And maybe say a little bit more about doctors who then say, no, I'm not interested in helping you with this.
Yeah, great question. So, you know, like you mentioned, it can be difficult to have these conversations, but the good thing is talking about death won't kill you. It actually can help you and your loved ones have a beautiful end-of-life experience. You know, I think of Atul Gawande, who says that everyone writes their own story, and every story has a last chapter. So think of your death as your final chapter in your unique book. How do you want it to end? As much as you can control it. In fact, we often compare death to birth. Right? I know as a mother, I had a birth plan. I knew what I wanted when my kids were born. Everything went well with my daughter. But when I had my son, he decided he wanted to be breached and things didn't go quite according to plan. But because I'd had all these birthing conversations, you know, my doctor, they knew what to do. So they knew what I wanted in different scenarios. And that's just as important in birth as it is in death. It's your unique death experience, and it has these ripple effects. You know, how you die does affect your loved ones. And so it really is a compassionate, loving thing to have these conversations early on, even though they can be difficult, because then people know what you want. And I really think we learn the most about life in talking about death. And so
right.
We do have resources on our website too that I encourage you to check out. We have something called an end of life decisions guide that we can mail you for free. It's a little booklet, or you can download it from our website, the end of life decisions guide. And it's really great because, you know, I keep saying, talk to your loved ones about what you want. Well, most people have no idea what they want because they don't know all the options. And so the great thing about
yes.
this booklet is, it can help you think through your values. Well, what do I value at the end of life? What is it that, like, you know, what is it that I want? And we also have a great tool called our Finish Strong tool that allows you to put together an addendum for your advanced healthcare directive specifically for dementia. Now, this is really important because a lot of people don't know there are different stages of dementia. And so depending on what stage you're at in dementia, you may want something different. And this tool actually allows you to go through kind of like a little quiz. So, for example, if you no longer recognize your family, you're bedridden, but you still seem happy, right? You still seem like you're in good spirits, you're still eating okay. well, what would you want? Do you want to extend life at all costs? Do you want, you know, one of these end-of-life options? So I mentioned refusing treatment. I want to mention a couple more just so people are aware.
Okay, and then we have some callers. So go ahead and mention a few more, and then I want to try and get some callers on. Yeah.
Okay, I'll do it quick. Voluntary stopping eating and drinking, I think, is an important one to talk about because a lot of times at the end of life, a person's body naturally shuts down. And we think the compassionate thing to do is to force feed them, to force liquids into them. But maybe it isn't what they would want. So voluntary stopping eating and drinking. And then palliative sedation is another option that patients sometimes choose that they can talk to their doctor about. But I'm curious, let's hear what the questions are.
Yeah, let's do that. Thank you. And there's a lot more to talk about. I have more questions, but let's take Karen in Petaluma right now. You're on About Health. Welcome. Let's see. Do we have Karen in Petaluma with us?
Can you hear me?
Yes, I can. Hi there.
Okay.
I can.
Wait, thank you, Nurse Renner, and to your guest. I love your show and appreciate it very much.
Thank you.
My situation is my husband and I have the same physician who we adore. He's wonderful for everything, but his practice got bought by Dignity. So I'm wondering if your guest has any thoughts about when it might be wise to switch to somebody who could prescribe assistive medications if that scenario seemed like it was approaching or perhaps before that. Thank you.
And Karen, right now you're both in good health. You're not in that fitting that criteria, I gather, right?
No, we're not fitting the criteria now, but you know, we both have our issues.
Yeah. Oh, well, thank you for that question. Samantha?
That's a great question, and I'm glad that you have a great physician. I would talk to your physician and see if they if this is the only place they work at. Sometimes there are physicians that are employed by more than one healthcare center, so then they can maybe do it out of another one. But it's, you know, I would start as soon as possible because, as everyone knows, health insurance, everything can just be so complicated. There's a doctor, Dr. Catherine Forrest, who lives in Santa Cruz, and she's been a longtime advocate for medical aid in dying. She's supported many patients in medical aid in dying. Her husband was it's always unexpected, but he was diagnosed with ALS and within a few months, reached the point where he knew he wanted medical aid in dying. And he too was at a Dignity Health facility. And so thankfully, one of his specialists was at Stanford. And so he was able to access the medication with his doctor at Stanford. And so,
that's really good advice.
Yeah. So I would start talking sooner than later, because even for Dr. Forrest, who knows so many people in this movement, it can still be hard to find a doctor. And I do want to let you know there's an organization called End of Life Choices California, End of Life Choices California. And you can call them. And if you can't find a doctor, they can try to help you find one. Again, it's End of Life Choices California, and you can go to their website and call their phone number.
And I just want to say that, you know, there's also people who have a diagnosis of terminal cancer, for example, who might find that they're getting anxious and scared about death, and that's a very normal response for us. You know, most people I know, really, really have trouble with just the concept of leaving their family, leaving this earth. And there are other options that I just want to mention, that there's been a lot of work with psychedelics, with psilocybin and other psychedelics, helping people who have anxiety or depression during that last phase of their life, during a terminal illness. So I'm just putting that out there, that there are other choices. And of course, there's always the choice to be part of hospice, knowing that the hospice pain management program is fantastic usually, and there's a lot of help to help people get through that final phase with the pain management that they need. So happy to take more questions about that, but let me get a caller in here. We have Ariane.
Rona.
Yeah. Oh, you want to say something, Samantha? Go ahead.
I just wanted to add one more thing about hospice. You know, we encourage everyone to enroll in hospice. And so once you get that, you know, terminal 6-month prognosis, ask your hospice, interview your hospice before you go on hospice. You know, make sure that your hospice staff can support you in medical aid and dying if that's the end of life option you want. Make sure the doctor you have through hospice will support you, because that's another way. Then you can stick with the doctor you have at Dignity Health and then access the medication through hospice.
Good. Thank you for that. We'll keep talking. 1-800-958-9008. Let's speak with Ariane in San Francisco.
Yes, hello. Thank you for exploring this important topic. I just want to say that we just in the West, in America particularly, we're the most materialistic country. And so we misconstrue life with the body, with the material form. And I think talking about death helps people be less afraid, and when we are less afraid, we might be more curious about it as an experience and more receptive and wondering what the gifts are. Many people at the end of their life, they just want their relatives' permission to leave, and we don't hear very much about that, and they want the blessing of the relatives, and it's really a lesson in detachment, and it's a lesson that we should be practicing all lifelong, but it's the ultimate lesson for us as we make a transition. And just to finish up, I recently did through the Alchemy Institute, I did a process in which I visualized my death, and it was very short. The Alchemy Institute's in Santa Rosa, but they do work over the phone. But what was so impactful for me is it freed up so much of my energy so that I could be more aware in my everyday life, because so much energy is tied up with that fear of death. And we know so little about death itself.
Well, I just want to appreciate you bringing up everything you've just said. It's beautifully said and really important. I was thinking about someone I know who did her obituary. And in this class I took, I took a class called Befriending Mortality, where they also talked about people doing their own obituary now while you're alive, to be thinking about also, what is it, you know, I want to continue to do? What is it I want from my life? And you also reminded me, thank you for the call, of a dear friend, Jen, who died recently. And it was a death like no other that I had been involved with. You know, as a nurse, I've been around some deaths, and she wasn't afraid. She wasn't resistant. She talked to people about what she was dealing with. She was open, and she was prepared. And I've kind of committed myself to understanding more about that process and how that's possible. So thank you for your call very much. Samantha, did you want to say anything to our last caller?
Just thank you. I completely agree. I love my work because it helps me appreciate life and every little moment that we have.
Yeah. Let me take an email here. We have an email from Eddie, and he says, what you're talking about today is a state law, which many in the disability community call physician-assisted suicide. And this is not something that I know at Compassion and Care. It's not called that, and I want you to address that. He says most disability activists who have organized around what he's calling physician-assisted suicide oppose the current state law and still organize against it nationally. Have you done a program featuring disability activists, or do you plan to? So that's an email from Eddie. Would you respond to that, Samantha?
Yeah, absolutely. And I think there's two parts to that email, and I'm glad that Eddie raised that. The first is, why do we call it medical aid in dying and not physician-assisted suicide? One of the things that I touched on earlier is that, you know, suicide is a really important thing that our country needs to address, that is being addressed. And the people who want medical aid in dying, the people who can qualify for medical aid in dying, they do not want to die. They absolutely do not want to die, but their terminal illness has robbed them of life. It is not the same thing as suicide. These are not people who are overwhelmed with depression, who are seeking to end their life. They are going to die imminently. These are people who are about to die. They're going to die no matter what. There's nothing left that can be done, and they just don't want to suffer at the end of life. And that's why they choose medical aid in dying. And that term, physician-assisted suicide, can be very offensive sometimes to people who want medical aid in dying, because, again, they do not want to die. They desperately want to live. But unfortunately, their terminal illness has robbed them of this option. And as we talked about, there's no assistance. You know, it's a self-administering act, which is really crucial. You know, our organization thinks that that self-ingestion is a core safeguard, because we don't want anyone to be coerced, and it's proven effective. You know, we've had medical aid in dying now for well over 20 years, starting in Oregon in the 90s, and there's never been a single incident of coercion or abuse. It's a safe and trusted law and practice. And I think there's a lot of maybe disinformation that sometimes the opposition pours out, because there are some people with disabilities who are very supportive of the option of medical aid in dying, but there are disability rights groups that oppose it. And I think that, you know, maybe it's a miscommunication. We do reach out to the disability rights group. We would love to work closer with disability rights groups, and we do. But again, there's a 13-step process in California to access the law. That's why we know it's safe and trusted.
I'm sorry. Go ahead. Finish.
Yeah. Well, I was just going to, I haven't even talked about all the steps on the call, but like we said, two different physicians have to say, yes, this person wants this option. You have to advocate for yourself. You have to show that you're mentally capable of understanding it. You know, you have to meet all these eligibility requirements. You also have a written request that has to be signed by two different qualified witnesses. At least one of the witnesses can't be up for an inheritance. You know, all of these different requirements.
Well, I think that's
make sure. Yeah.
I think that's the important part. That when I've talked to people who are, you know, worried about it, what they say is, you know, they really are worried that someone would be coerced, or that the person, you know, with a disability might do it because they don't want to be a burden, you know, financially to the rest of the family. So I think that's where what I'm learning now, because I'm not an expert in this at all, is that there are so many safeguards in place, and if those things really happen, if the doctors mm-hmm. make sure and do what's needed, then it looks like, you know, these steps will make a big difference. So I think I'm going to have to do a show at some point with folks from the disability community to find out more about what the reluctance is, and, you know, where there may be misinformation or where there may be stories that people need to tell as well. So I'm just saying that I'm glad this person brought it up, and I thank you, Samantha, for pointing out that there's so much in place to protect people. I think that's what you're saying, correct?
Yeah, and data. You know, we have data from across the country. Thousands of people have accessed medical aid in dying, and again, there's never been a single incident of coercion or abuse. We can prove it. We have the data. We have the safeguard. So there's an overwhelming amount of evidence to show that this is a safe and trusted practice.
Thank you. Let's take more calls. 1-800-958-9008. Joel, thanks for waiting. Joel from San Francisco, you're on About Health.
Thank you. So I have my own perspectives on things, and I was wondering if you have any idea about the karma of taking your own life at a specific time when maybe you're not ready to transition, that you could just wind up being a spirit, you know, without. Anyway, I don't know if that means anything to you, but
I didn't quite understand, Joel. Do you mean for someone who fits the criteria, like who has a terminal illness?
Anybody. If your time to die is not now, and you believe in the transition of the soul, then and you take your own life where that leads you, your spirit wise. I don't know if that's a subject you can speak to. Yeah.
That's a hard one, because it sounds like someone who isn't thinking of taking their life because of a terminal illness, but because of other reasons. Is that right? Is that what you're saying?
No. The karma of dying at your own choice under any reason. Like, if you believe in transition of the soul, how it affects that, but you might not mm-hmm. believe that. So,
I see what you're saying now. I think
not something you could answer, maybe.
Okay, right. I think I'm trying to understand your question. So you're saying, you know, what's the karma of someone taking their life versus letting that process happen naturally? Is that right?
Well, if you believe there's a transition in the soul where you will get another body, like, then what's your condition when you take your own life? That's
I hear what you're saying. It's a very deep question. It's a very deep question, mm-hmm. and it's something for every person to really grapple with. Samantha, go ahead.
Sure. I would just say, you know, I definitely am not in a position to speak to that, but I just want to remind everyone that people who choose medical aid in dying are imminently dying, right? So this is a person who is about to die, who chooses medical aid in dying to peacefully end their suffering. And we know that 30% of the people who go through the whole process don't even take their medication. They end up letting their terminal illness take its course. And what our organization's mission is, I think, is really beautiful. It's to empower everyone to chart their own end-of-life journey. So that means whatever your spiritual practice is, you should be empowered to be able to chart your own end-of-life journey the way you want it, because this is your precious, unique life, and it's your precious, unique end-of-life. And even talking about death can be complicated because, as Joel kind of mentioned, you know, not everyone sees this as the end, right? We have different beliefs. And so we're really focused on patient autonomy at the end of life. And that's what we are working to do at Compassion and Choices.
Good. Thank you. And thank you, Joel, for your question. This is a good time for me to read a poem. This is a poem by a man named Steve Zimmerman. He served on the board of the San Francisco chapter of Compassion and Choices for several years. He volunteered because he felt really strongly that people should have the right to die on their own terms with dignity and avoiding unnecessary suffering. And he's now 89, and he feels, he said, more strongly than ever about the right to die on his own terms. So here's his poem. When you've reached the end of life, hopefully with a minimum of tears and strife, and death is knocking at your door, take my advice. Don't ask for more. You may regret what you're asking for. Ahead lies only sickness and misery from doctors who insist on your longevity. Old age and sickness is serious business. It's even worse when it's cancer, for which there is no answer. Whether rich or poor, this is a fate no one should endure. So if the pain is too great, there's no reason to wait. If you're able, while your mind is still stable, take the quick and easy way out, exit by a compassionate route. Thank you, Steve Zimmerman, for your poem. And I do want to say the one line, even worse when it's cancer, I just want to say that I'm just so grateful that there are a lot of cures these days, palliative care for people with cancer. And I know many people have lived a long time with a diagnosis of cancer who then extend their life is extended and they have still a joyful life, just like you mentioned, Samantha, with your mom.
Yeah, I hate cancer so much, and I'm so glad that there are so many treatments. My mother-in-law is going through treatment for cancer right now, and it's just so painful, but I'm grateful for all of the medication that can help people to extend their life as they are able to. But it is also important to recognize that eventually, hopefully, when we're very, very old, we all will face end of life. And so it's really important that we understand our options and that we're empowered to make those decisions.
You know, I have an email from someone named Harry, and he said he'd like to know something about insurance. He believes that if someone dies of suicide, that it can invalidate their life insurance policy. And he's wondering if that would be similar in the case of someone who dies by medical aid in dying. And he's just thinking about someone who buys insurance with the purpose of providing protection for their family, and then suddenly that could be gone. And he said, maybe I'm mistaken, and I can see that that would be, a real priority. So any advice about this for Harry?
Absolutely. Yeah, that's a great question. We get asked that all the time. So part of the law, part of the End of Life Option Act, actually requires that the underlying terminal illness is what is written on the death certificate. Because again, these are people who are imminently dying. So it doesn't say suicide on the death certificate because it's not a suicide. The underlying illness is what is listed on the death certificate. And it's written in the law too that this cannot affect life insurance, annuity policies. There's no negative effect, no consequences for choosing the option of medical aid in dying. But I will mention, in the 90s, Congress passed a federal funding restriction. So no federal dollars are allowed to go towards medical aid in dying, which means that Medicare cannot cover the cost of the aid in dying medication. This is also true for veterans benefits. So if you're at the VA, your doctors are not going to be allowed to participate. California, Medi-Cal, our state Medicaid, does cover medical aid in dying. So if you are a Medicaid patient, then you can receive the medication through Medicaid, will cover it. And so a lot of people most private insurance does cover medical aid in dying, but a lot of people also just choose to pay out of pocket. Right now, the medication is between about $400 to $600.
That's good to know. To know. That was a great question, because I can imagine people really being concerned about insurance and the fact that the illness is what shows up on the death certificate is really valuable. Someone just sent me a message. I don't know who it is. It says, what about complexities of talking to family? What do you think, Samantha? How would you like to answer that?
That's a question. So one of the things we're really committed to at Compassion and Choices is diversity, equity, and inclusion. And so what we've learned is that different communities talk about death differently. A lot of communities really don't like to talk about death at all. It's so hard. And so I can give a lot of advice for how to kind of bring up the topic. But it's really, your loved ones best. So I always say, use us as an excuse. You could say, I listened to this interesting radio interview with Nurse Rona, and they talked about this. And so I just thought we could take a moment to, let's talk about it tonight. You could plan it. Food. I always love conversations around food. Food is such a beautiful, wonderful cultural thing. Whatever it is you drink, if you drink alcohol or not drink alcohol, you gotta figure that out for the people, your loved ones. And I know people who, they have a healthcare proxy, they've made their videos, they've done all their things, and they just will not have the conversation with their family because they don't think their family can handle it. And, you know, every person's different. I really encourage everyone to try to find a way to talk to your family about it. There's some great movies. There's a film called Here a While with Anna Camp and Jolo Truglio. It's on Prime, if you have Amazon Prime. And it's about a woman who chooses the option of medical aid and dying. It's Anna Camp in this. She's been in a number of films. And it's a really beautiful film. So maybe, you know, having a movie night with your family, if that's something that your family maybe does. So you can watch a movie.
What's the name again, Sam?
It's called Here a While.
Okay, good. That's mm-hmm. really great. And I think sometimes we're really surprised by the fact. It's like talking with kids about sex. I mean, we're all, you know, as parents, we're always nervous about that one. But sometimes we're really surprised. And I think if you go into the conversation not thinking about it being the only conversation, but thinking about it as a starting conversation, remembering that defensiveness never helps, but just being curious about people's thoughts, ideas, make it short if you can, or at least not hours long where everyone gets exhausted, but also say, let's have a series of conversations if we can, and then you'll really know where people stand in terms of their comfort about talking about death. I mean, I think I like to be respectful and not, you know, push anyone to talk about death if they don't want to, but also invite that conversation if possible. Greg in Palo Alto, thanks for joining the conversation. You're on About Health.
Yeah, I'll try to make this as brief as I can. Thank you. A couple of things. One, my guess is that I fall within that group of people in America who do have their concerns and fears about dying, but that's not the reason I called. I watched my father, who was 101, and was in a, I guess it was a nursing home, I'm not sure. He had developed a serious infection in his leg, and it would have meant amputating his leg. And so they decided, now, I wasn't involved in this because I didn't have much contact with my dad at the end of his life, but I did go over to the nursing home often to watch what was happening. And the thing is, he was unresponsive, I mean, to say the least. I don't know if he was medicated or not, but all they were doing was, because they weren't giving him food or water. Now, this may have been what he had signed up for. I don't know, because I didn't talk to him about this prior to this situation. But all they were doing were just moistening his lips, you know, with a sponge. That was it. So they were just waiting for him to die. And I thought about this a lot, and I just thought, you know, I don't know what was going on inside his brain or his nervous system with regard to what was happening, but certainly depriving somebody at any age of food and water ultimately is going to lead to your death. And I don't know if he was in pain that didn't register, but you know, I'll tell you the truth. If I had been in a position to give him a shot of morphine to put him out of his misery and hasten his death, I would have done it.
Sure.
Because I had a hard time watching this happen over a period of months, and just there was. Yeah,
anyway. Greg, you're saying so much there. I just want to respond and give Samantha time to respond since we're running a little out of time. But I really appreciate you giving this as an example to respond to, Greg. I'll speak for a minute and then I'll hand it over to you, Samantha. You know, you bring up the point of how hard it is when there isn't that communication, you know, because sometimes we're not in contact with our family member. And so when we come into a situation and if we don't know what the advance directive is, and we don't know what our family member wants, it makes us really at a disadvantage. And this is where hospice is so important. When hospice became available, you know, many years ago, it was like this bright light, because here are a group of people who understood the death process, who knew what they were doing, and they knew what a person could receive to help them die more comfortably. And I've watched people die, and I've seen them have a fentanyl patch or morphine, just enough so that they could not have pain, but not too much so that they would be out of it. And it was very compassionate. Not getting food or water. Usually they do give water or give something to little sips of water or keeping their mouth moist. But there are different ways to help a person pass compassionately. But we need to be working with the facility, with the family, and hopefully knowing the person's desires. And your instinct to help your father not be in pain is just such a natural instinct that we all, I think, feel when someone's dying. Samantha, go ahead. You have a minute.
Yeah, absolutely. Sure. So I would just say, you know, the default at most senior living facilities and really all of our healthcare institution is to extend life as long as possible, no matter what. And so voluntary stopping eating and drinking was an end-of-life option I mentioned briefly. It usually only takes a week or two. But again, you know, it's really important to know what the person, what your loved one will want in that situation. And I've heard so many stories just similar where you didn't know what your loved one wanted and you wish you knew. You wish you could give them what you think their compassionate end-of-life option is. And again, that's why having these conversations, if you really can't have a conversation, write a letter, you know, make a video, do something so that your loved ones have a roadmap to help you when you can't advocate for yourself, so that everyone can be at peace and know that they're able to support you in your end of life experience. And thank you for calling in and for sharing that. It's very powerful, and I think a lot of people can relate to it.
Yeah, and you know, I know I'd like to live a long time. I want to see my grandkids grow up, and I also want to be aware of the fact that, you know, we all die. And if we can talk with our loved ones about this, it can help everyone. And I just encourage people to do this the best they can. So, a final word, Samantha. You've given us so much good information today. Mm.
Thank you, Nurse Rona, for having me on. And I just want to encourage everyone. Thank you, first of all, for listening, for considering this, and try not to be afraid. This is each of our last chapters. Find a way to talk to those that you need to talk to about your end of life decisions, about what they want. And I think a lot of beauty can come from these conversations.
And you can go to the website for Compassion and Choices. Thank you so much, Samantha. And I need to say goodbye to everyone and thank Kirsten Thomas at the controls. I also want you to know you can go to nurserona.com if you missed any part of the show. And be careful about taking in the news. We're all so traumatized by this horrific war in Ukraine. And if you have children around, try and not have the TV on. You know, listen to the radio, but turn those images off so that it's not too traumatic for you. Think about Fred Rogers and talk about the people who are helping. We have to take in the good where we can. So this is Nurse Rona saying goodbye. Till next time.
Carlo Santana.
You know, every time I take a solo on my guitar, I'm telling the story. So I learned from my father and B.B. King and Miles. The reason I mention all of them is because I am them. I identify with their spirit. All of them taught me to tell a story. I am a master storyteller, you know, and I utilize melody or friends like you, your heart and your pen and journalists to pass the word through the stories. Miracles and blessings are very close to you. Will you come forward and receive them?
KPFA, storytelling for social change.
You're listening to 94.1 KPFA and 89.3 KPFB in Berkeley, 88.1 KFCF in Fresno, 97.5 K248BR in Santa Cruz, and online worldwide at KPFA.